It is so absolutely important to continue your momentum, your quest today for truth, and not allow any gaps in your effort, because any gaps are there, you quickly spiral down towards death and identifying with impermanence as if impermanence is some kind of mandate from God, which it is not. We misinterpret God's non-judgment, perfect non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, all what-ifs. We misinterpret it as if it's some mandate for us to explore impermanence and try to establish a home in impermanence. That's a 180-degree misinterpretation of it, which is what binds us here to this nightmare. We think that God is saying, hey, here's this nightmare for you of impermanence, and your mandate is to go out there and make the most of it and see what you can do with it. That is absolutely not true. Completely upside down and backwards. The non-judgment, God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, is simply telling us that hypotheticals do not affect reality in the slightest bit and never will. And so and only reality is real. So they have no meaning, no relevance, they're nothing at all. And that the Son of God, the one who's dreaming, entertaining these hypotheticals, is not affected by the hypotheticals at all. Never will be. That's what God has to do with hypotheticals, has to have this perfect non-judgment. But what we misinterpret it, we think that it's like God has placed this zone of nothingness between reality and hypotheticals, and that this zone of nothingness is to scare us in, or to basically motivate us or keep us bound to impermanence so that we don't bail on it. So that, and then there's some super significant, important outcome of our work with impermanence, that God is giving us this like supreme challenge to prove we're worthy of the sonship, you see. That is how we interpret it. And so we are frantically working in impermanence, believing it's a mandate, it is our destiny, it's the way we prove how worthy we are. And all this is completely false and upside down and backwards and wrong. But herein lies the challenge of being in this world. You come into this world and everybody here is completely cuckoo, with the rare exceptions of the therapists, the true therapists here who know the truth about this. And so everybody says, welcome, welcome, welcome here. You know, you're here to work. You're here to put fragments together, and you're here to suffer death and suffer all these problems, but don't worry, all your efforts are not in vain, that God appreciates each and every effort here to work on impermanence and make impermanence a home, and to adjust to impermanence, and to all this accept your lot in life here, and that you will be richly rewarded in the afterlife. And so you come into this complete madhouse. And you try to tell people, hey people, this is, you got it backwards, and they think that you're depriving them of their prize. So they think that working on impermanence is going to give them a prize, that God will say, oh, I'm so pleased in my son who has given themselves over to death and misery and suffering and nightmares and confusion and despair and alienation and separation, all for my sake, you know, that just to prove how much they love me and all this stuff. So they think there's some huge prize for continuing on with this. Not true. And they invent these prizes. We just make up stuff here in existence. Not only is existence a hypothetical make-believe scenario, but we just make up all the rules, all the laws, and all the motivation as we go along. If we need motivation, we just make it up and say, oh, you know, this is what God said, and this is what God wants us to do, and or this is what inherently our potential is leading us to, or there's some inexorable evolutionary process that we are simply part of this current that is mysterious, but there's, you know, nothing we can do about it, et cetera. We just make it all up as we go along, make up our motivation as we go along. None of it is true. What is true is that the only issue we have is a continuity issue between hypotheticals and no hypotheticals. And we're nervous about setting down hypotheticals entirely because this feeling of, well, We're so used to hypotheticals. How would we function without hypotheticals? So there's this continuity issue. God gives the blessing of non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. That's experienced here as bliss, steady state, unconditional love, the overlay, vision of oneness, whatever you want to call it. And that solves the continuity issue for us entirely, because it mirrors reality. It reflects how reality really is. In other words, no judgment upon hypotheticals. In fact, reality doesn't even, has no knowledge of hypotheticals whatsoever. Okay, reality wasn't created for hypotheticals. So bliss maintains the hypotheticals, except it's a blanket non-judgment upon all, equal non-judgment upon all, concurrent with everything, all hypotheticals, concurrent. Same instant. It's not a process like first there's hypotheticals and then we judge, place a non-judgment upon that. It's concurrent with the hypotheticals. That's very important. It's concurrent, not before and not after. So this so-called nothingness is not nothingness. It's God's non-judgment upon nothingness. Okay? So we're not lost in nothingness. We have God's non-judgment upon it, which is bliss. Sure, hypotheticals are nothing. That's true. They're absolutely nothing at all. They're just all these different forms of nothing, symbolizing nothing. We're just symbolizing nothing in infinite ways, and then claiming that this is God's desire for us, that this is what God wants us to do, and we're doing some special operation for God, and we'll be richly rewarded. Not true. The fact is we're doing this because we want to supplant God as prime creator. That's why we're doing it. We want Spirit wants to become the prime creator instead of the prime created. So again, we're just making up this idea that this notion that God is putting us on this special mission, and that hides the fact of what we're really trying to do is destroy reality, destroy God, destroy reality. And God just reminds us that reality can't be destroyed, so there's no worries. And just set down hypotheticals when you're ready to, and here's the intermediate step of bliss. Very simple. So the world has it backwards. This world is a God-forsaking place, absolutely God-forsaking place, where we just put words and concepts into God's mouth and say, this is what God is telling us to do. This is what God wants for us. All self-serving, all serving to hide what we're really trying to do and to hide from God and to terrify ourselves about God and to believe that if we don't do this, we'll end up with nothing, you know. Well, hypotheticals are nothing, but if we don't entertain hypotheticals, what do we get? Everything always is. It's impossible not to have everything. We can dream that we have nothing, but we still have everything. We've not been dispossessed at all. There is no such thing as dispossession. There's only dreams of dispossession. And God says you can't just dispossess yourself. So blanket not judgment upon all attempts to do so, knowing that all of attempts are equally futile. You see, all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. So there's only one need for one blanket non-judgment upon all of them. And I say non-judgment, meaning there's no need to judge anything. There's no need to pass any judgment. Because if they're all equally futile, what's the need for any judgment at all? So you can say it's a blanket non-judgment. God says, don't need to judge anything. That's experienced here as bliss. And that's the goal. And yet this world is so inexorably opposed to that. It's an absolutely God-forsaking place. This planet is the place where people go who are so interested in trying to forsake God and trying to place themselves in the position of prime creator. They come here to this world and pursue their quests as if it's a mandate from God that they do so. You know, evolve. They're here to evolve. They're here to develop human potential. That's the you want to talk about potential? How about experiencing bliss? That's our true potential. And that's not human potential, that's spirit potential. Potential to resolve the continuity issue. That is what we really need to focus on. and not as some human potential, not as some evolutionary step, not as some figuring out of how to make it exist in permanence work for us or any of that kind of stuff. No, it's a recognition that it was futile from the very beginning, that God never mandated it. Absolutely not. God did give us freedom, but that's not a mandate to choose to try and destroy freedom. It's not a mandate for that. We can do that. We can choose that. We're free to choose it, but God didn't mandate it. And God knew that we would choose that at some point just because we're so adventurous. So God was aware that this perfect non-judgment needed to be concurrent with our choosing of that concurrent. So it perfectly parallels it, and it's always available for us. This is the momentum that has to be carried into each day. Otherwise, the day slips away and we spiral downward so rapidly. It's frightening. Can you change the world's attitudes and stuff? No. What I've found is that this world continues to be a place for the God-forsaken. And that's what it's known for. And it's been a great disappointment to see the progress that we thought we made in this world, that the newer generations, those who arrive here, the new arrivals here in this on this planet, by and large, are here for the purposes of God-forsaken. And there is the momentum stops, falls flat tire, and starts regressing severely. So it's not like this planet is evolving or it's getting higher. Now, how can the planet be evolving when the people coming here are more entrenched in delusion than ever? You know, they're hardcore delusion self-deceivers, hardcore self-deceivers coming on this planet, very hardcore. So of course this is what this planet does. You know, it's like a dive bar. A really, really dive bar. And of course attracts all those who like that situation. So the goal is don't try to change this planet. It is what it is. It's a place for those who want to have, you know, extreme forgetfulness, extreme delusion. It's all set up for that. The answer is to relocate to some other place, which is set up for remembrance of God, which is set up to support bliss, experience of bliss, the acceptance of bliss, set up for that. That's the wise, intelligent thing to do. Again, and those who think they need to stay here and change this world, they are, again, believing that God has some mandate to, again, do that, which is not true at all. God is unaware of this world, unaware of dreams, unaware of the content. God's aware that we're dreaming, yes, but pays no attention to the content whatsoever. No attention to the content whatsoever. So, it's the Holy Spirit that makes right use of time, and that's able to guide us and say, okay, what's the best situation for you? And this world here is the best situation for those who want to deceive themselves, who want to continue on with hypotheticals, who want to hide from God. It's a great hiding place, if you can even say that, because God's not paying any attention to our dreams. God knows where the sun is. The sun is not lost. God's perfectly aware. Just can't hide. There's nowhere to hide in reality. And just because we have dreams, these dark dreams, and think we're hiding there is just nonsense. So this world will continue to be what it is. It did not turn into a star as forecast on March 21st. That's not going to happen. Now, the desire to hide from God brings about radical changes along the way, as it's a continual effort. And so this world will be remodeled, absolutely. And that may be another place to hide from God. But again, none of that means anything to God. God does not pay any attention to our dreams, the content of our dreaming, none. Totally overlooks it. Now, if you have a child and the child is having a nightmare, what do? You just maintain your awareness of the surroundings, which are perfectly peaceful and safe. And so when the child sees you, you're smiling, you're relaxed, and the child says, oh, there's no worries. I can see that they get that reassurance. Whereas if you try to enter into nightmares and you're seeing all this terror and darkness and death and attack and all this stuff, then you're going to be all jittery and you'll forget that all this is just a dream. So God does not enter into dreams with us. Does not. And does not mandate any type of dream whatsoever. Is totally not, does not enter into the content of any dreaming, any hypotheticals. What if this were possible? So we're deluding ourselves to think that God is micromanaging the universe and is profoundly interested in our human life and what we're doing with the human lives. Absolutely not true. The Holy Spirit is micromanaging everything from the standpoint of right use of time, but not from the standpoint of content of dreams, only from the standpoint of right use of time to lead us to bliss, to acceptance of God's perfect non-judgment, perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all what ifs. That's what the Holy Spirit does. That was a special creation. There was a creation of the Prime Creator, as it were, a blessing upon all hypotheticals. But God the Father, God the Prime Creator, does not enter into dreams at all. Maintains a perfect awareness that dreams are entirely unnecessary. They never will be necessary. The scenario of what if reality were destroyed, we don't need a contingency plan for that. We don't need a hypothetical contingency plan at all. So the Holy Spirit is aware of everything, absolutely, and orchestrates everything, but only from the standpoint of, again, helping us overcome our fear of God. Only from that standpoint. The rest is our own doing. It's our own dreaming. We're the ones who are doing the dreaming. And we've set it up to make it seem like the dream has its own momentum. But still, who's sustaining the dream, the dreamer? So we can dream a dream that seems to be self-functioning, right? Like nature. Nature seems to be self-functioning. But who is sustaining the dream of nature? That's the question, right? We are. Spirit's sustaining it. Nature is not sustaining itself. But we look at nature from a human standpoint. We say, well, nature is just sustaining itself. No, it's not true. It's like a dream. When you're having a dream, and the dream seems to be sustaining itself. And when you wake up, you realize, no, it wasn't sustaining itself. That you were dreaming it. You were dreaming the entire thing out of desire and wish. The world is like that. It's not sustaining itself. But any aspect of spirit that wants to engage in hypotheticals will sustain a dream. So it's not like if one aspect decides that they don't want to dream that dream anymore, that their dream disappears for everybody. No. Not at all. Plus, we accept bliss, which is an overlay of the dreaming. So the dreaming remains. The sustaining of the dreaming is still there, but it's overlaid. There's no judgment upon it. If you want to have perfect non-judgment upon all these dreams and accept that symbolically, then there needs to be symbols upon which to symbolize that. Put that symbol on, like a sticker on it. Like a sticker, say the sticker of non-judgment. Let me put a sticker of non-judgment upon this computer screen. Well, if you want to put a sticker of non-judgment upon something, which is a symbol, you need to have something to put it on. So, of course, the dream will remain, but it will be a non-judged dream. And then from that, once you get used to the non-judged dream, then you can set all dreaming down. So that's how it works. That's God's plan of salvation. That's exactly how it works. And we need to sustain our awareness of this on a daily basis. Otherwise, I mean, if you just, I don't say try this, but it's going to happen anyway, where you have a day where you slack off a little bit for a little while. And you will rapidly realize that you've completely forgotten all truth, all true teachings altogether. Just poof, gone. Where is it? What happened to it? You don't know. Wow. That's how much forgetfulness this world has of truth, where everyone thinks that this dream is self-sustaining, that it created us, that we're the creations of this dream, that we're human bodies being a creation of this dream. And see, we made a dream that is producing all these effects, and we think the production of these effects, it means the dream is sustaining all these effects, like an effect producer, like a kaleidoscope. But who's sustaining the kaleidoscope? See, sure, there's all this reflectivity in the kaleidoscope, and it seems the kaleidoscope is producing all these effects. But again, who is producing the kaleidoscope is the question. Who is producing nature? Who is dreaming nature? And of course, we claim it's God. No, God is doing it, which means, of course, it's not us. So, again, denying causation and denying that it's a dream. So we're not sustaining it. If we say God is doing it, we say, well, we're not sustaining it. It's not us. In other words, so we're denying the dream, what the dreamer is doing. It's a great way to hide from truth and maintain the whole charade. Or we say, nobody's doing it. No one's doing it. It's sustaining itself. That's another funny one. Two sides of the same mistake. The deists and the atheists are two sides of one mistake. Either one says, God is sustaining it, created, made all this, and sustaining all. The atheists say, nothing made this, and nothing is sustaining it. It's just self-sustained. It made itself, and it's all self-sustaining. Each one leaves out the true causation, which is us, spirit, is the one who's dreaming this. Imagine if you're having a dream, and in the dream, you're saying, hey, what's going on? Where did all this come from? You're looking around, and there's a figure in the dreams looking around at the world and everything. I had a dream last night. It's unbelievable. The detail and the stonework, my gosh. I'm driving on roads that are completely made of stone block pavers, and the walls, and the whole hillside, 100% made of these stones. Like a yellow brick road, following the yellow brick road and going, it was just like amazing. But, so we'd say, well, where did all these stones come from? Where did the stone work come from? Well, it just came out of nothing, and it's just sustaining itself, and it's all a mystery, and we don't know. Oh, okay. Or we say, yeah, God put this all here. It's the work of God. And we say, wow, that's amazing. And of course, when we take those two positions, there's a deception there in the dreaming, whereas the dreamer is denying that they're the ones doing the dreaming. They're denying it. They say, no, I'm not doing this dreaming. God's doing it, or no one's doing it. So it's a way of perpetuating the dreaming, right? But if the dreamer, if there's someone in the dream that says, hey, I think I'm the one who's doing this dreaming, the dreamer is me. I'm just making up these symbols of myself in this dream. Then the dreamer will realize, yes, I'm doing the dreaming. But no need to stop dreaming, just accept the overlay of dreaming, of the perfect non-judgment, you see, perfect non-judgment upon all dreaming. So then everything is equally blissful, vision of bliss. We don't seem to get too many of those in the world anymore. If any. Not readily accessible. I mean, I don't know. We are so into our delusions now that, hey, we can manipulate this dream. The dream is, we're capable of manipulating the dream, so why wake up from it? That's kind of the motif of the times, right? It's like the idea of waking up from the dream is an anathema to those here on this planet now. It's sacrilege, it's blasphemy. Because we say, my God, why would we want to wake up from this dream? Look at all the ways that we can manipulate this dream. My gosh, we get the heavy earth movers. We get the high-tech stuff. We can decontaminate everything. We can pull out energy out of a hat. We can have smart everything. We can meter everything. We can make sure every single person on the planet is towing the line as far as their carbon footprint. We can turn this dream into a marvelous, wonderful place. a nice prison planet of everybody on the same page, making sure they all work to make this dream a better dream. So the idea of saying, hey, why don't we just realize that we're the ones who are dreaming this dream. We're the ones that are sustaining it, and it's an attempt to try to overcome reality, destroy reality, and replace reality with our own reality, and therefore making us prime creator. And it's all hypotheticals. It's all completely meaningless to reality. It has no effect on reality whatsoever. It's all completely futile and impossible. And that God has given a perfect non-judgment upon all this. And that's bliss, and we can accept bliss, and that solves the continuity problem. See, that's the right way of looking at it. But the world is not interested in that way at all. It's interested in saying, my gosh, you know, look at how we can manipulate this dream, matter, you know, energy, matter. We're so smart, we're so talented, we can bioengineer everything, we can produce millions of different kinds of drugs. And we can take these drugs and feel better. Of course, every time we take a drug, it creates numerous side effects, which we need to take numerous other drugs for that, which create even more numerous side effects. We're using up all the rare metals on the planet for all the technology, and pretty soon we'll be out of those. We're destroying the oceans. We're using up all the natural resources of energy sources, oil and gas, and fracking the land, chopping down the forests, burning holes in the ozone, etc., etc., etc. Yeah, it's a great dream. But don't worry, we have 1,000 channels on your big screen that you can sit there like zombies watching all day with your drugs. And don't feel like working, no problem. Food stamps and welfare for everybody. And free medical care. Well, it's not free, but... I know somebody that got in an accident. They had this cheap health care provider, which is what everything's going to be. And instead of saving the leg, which they could have, but it would have cost them a lot of money to go through the right procedures to save the leg, they just amputated it right then and there. That's what we're headed towards, the dream. You know, it's a ghastly dream we're heading towards. But as you know, marketers, what do? They market. You see, there's a ton of people in this world who are enthralled with the idea of marketing for the sake of marketing. They're enthralled with their cleverness. Like, hey, I can, market refrigerators to Eskimos. How clever of me. And just they're caught up in their own cleverness, so they think they can market this world. Say, well, what a wonderful future we're going to have. Just, it's fantastic, wonderful. Those are just marketers. Those are just advertisers. They don't care whether they're deceiving you or not. They take pride in their ability to deceive and mislead. That's what advertisers do, marketers. They mislead and deceive, and they feel that this is a sign of their intelligence. It's a justification for them being here. It's a mandate from God to make this world seem more attractive than it is, so that we don't forsake it and throw it and say, hey, I don't want this. God didn't say we have to set down this idea. It's just saying, when you want to, here's this perfect non-judgment. Because God created us with free will, choose any idea we want. So God can't say, oh, you can't choose this idea. No, he said, you can choose this idea, but you're not going to like it. So I'm going to give a concurrent, perfect, internal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. That solves the continuity issue for you, because I know you're going to want to set it down. It's not going to be any fun whatsoever for you. But again, God's not pressuring us to set it down. It's we're the ones who want to set it down because we don't like it. And God understands that. God knows that we don't like it. But again, we're free to entertain this ridiculous idea of destroying reality as long as we want. But it's going to be suffering, suffering, suffering. And what we do is we keep marketing the future to ourselves and making the future seem like it's this rosy, rosy place. I mean, just look at history. We're continuously marketing the future to ourselves. Imagine the 20th century, how we came into the 20th century. We were marketing what an incredibly great world this was and all the advancements, and we're going to utopia, and then World War I happened, and it just blew everyone's mind. Really, how could this happen? We thought we had marketed this wonderful future, and this happened. And so the world was appalled after World War I. The world was appalled at this, and they said, you know what? This is never, ever, ever going to happen again, and we are going to make a great, great future, and it is going to be world peace, world happiness. And so they worked at that, and they marketed the future to themselves again, how wonderful it's going to be. And they said, we are going to make sure this never happens again. And what they didn't realize is they put such onerous conditions on the Germans that it caused chaos in Germany, which gave rise to a demagogue who then provided the simple directives to people they're willing to follow. And before you know it, they had a juggernaut. And of course, over in Japan, you had another situation of expansion, imperialism, etc. And suddenly World War II happened, which is even worse than World War I. I mean, World War II was absolutely terrible. Global conflagration. And this, again, came upon people like, how could this possibly happen? We had marketed this more rosy future to ourselves. So after the war again, what happened? People marketed a rosy future to themselves again. However, not everybody in the world is that deluded, is willing to delude themselves to that extent. So some people came in the world and said, hey, no, wait a minute. Folks, you're painting this rosy future to us. Now just wait just a minute. Just a minute. Didn't you paint that rosy picture before World War I, after World War I? I mean, go back in history. And now you're painting, on what basis are you affirming this? Is it just simply wishful thinking, self-delusion, or is it actually rooted in truth? If you look at all the conflicts in the 20th century, it's just unbelievable. You realize that there's just been non-stop conflicts, and the planet is, you know, is just the rose. I mean, after World War II, if you're a baby boomer, the picture that was painted was so rosy. I mean, my gosh. Americana, you know, the suburbs, to get a new car every 3 years. It's just up, 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 up and away to this wonderful future. And science is going to solve all problems. We're going to have the most incredibly great, beautiful glass and aluminum homes. We're going to have flying cars. We're going to have just everything is going to be incredibly amazing and wonderful. And wow. The world was our oyster. And poverty would be gone. Sickness would be gone. We're going to conquer everything. I guess they didn't plan on AIDS coming along. Of course, then the Vietnam War, weren't planning on that, you see. And of course, the Korean War came along too, but they weren't planning on cocaine and, you know, infiltrating the country, and marijuana and crack and heroin and methamphetamines and every other kind of drug scourge imaginable. They weren't planning on all the decadence that came in, all the rot, all the decay, all the social upheaval, all this kind of stuff. They weren't planning on any of that. They weren't planning on all the pollution, all the destruction of the environment, the problems with all the planet, and all. No. It was all super rosy future. Okay, so we market the future to ourselves. To delude ourselves so we don't get on the spiritual path. That's why we do it. Because if you think the future of this dream is wonderful, why would you want to wake up from the dream? Or why would you want to accept the means to set dreams down, which is bliss? Why? You'd say, oh, you know, I got to go to college, I got to get a degree, I got to work in a chemistry lab, we're going to develop some of these synthetic products that are just unbelievable and going to make you happy as a hog in a pigsty, you know. You're going to be so happy because you got these wonder products. You got Teflon now. You got plexiglass. I mean, these things were, you know, big deal. We got hula hoops. Hey. Look at this, plastics, my gosh. And then we started saying, hey, wait a minute, this plastic's got a problem. You know, how do they decompose? And microchips are here now, you know, and just on and on and on. So we keep marketing the dream to ourselves so we don't say, wait a minute, wait, you know, what about all the suffering? What about all the severe depressions? Oh, don't worry, we got all these great antidepressants. Really? And I take the antidepressants, and what happens if you feel worse? And if there's all these side effects, and these, you realize these are super, super toxic kind of drugs. And they say, oh, no, we're going to have better and better and better. Don't worry. So always, science always has the answer in the future, don't they? And the advertisers always have the answer in the future. And the social engineers always have the answer in the future. Don't worry, we'll have universal medical coverage for everybody. And no matter what happens to you, you're going to be taken care of in the very best way. Now, you're going to wait 6 months to see a doctor, and you get in there, and the doctor's going to say, here, take this, take these strong medicines, and if you have any other problem, call me. Bye. You know? That's what it's going to be like. They're going to do the quickest, most, everything's going to be cost effective. All right? It's all cost effective. It's all bureaucratic juggernaut. You're going into a nightmare, actually. The future is a nightmare. And yet we have deceived ourselves into thinking that is a wonderful utopia. It's a dystopia. Future is a dystopia, as it's always been. I mean, if you get to the beginning of human civilization, look at it. If you saw it all laid out on a magic carpet, on a film, watching this film, you'd have to say it's a dystopia, an extreme dystopia. An extreme dystopia. You know, Europe's perking along, and it's making all this progress, and then suddenly, what happens? Some flea from some ground squirrel in Mongolia somehow migrates, gets into rats, and rats get on ships, and those ships dock in ports of Europe, and those rats leave the ships. The fleas get into the countryside. They start multiplying, and they start biting people, and they carry this virus, a little bug in them that gets into people, and it causes the bubonic plague, and a third of Europe gets destroyed. That wasn't too much fun. And then the scourge of smallpox, you know, breaks out all over the place, and the scourge of the bird flu, Spanish influenza, breaks out. You know, terrorizing the globe. Now we have terrorism terrorizing the globe, you know. Just on and on and on and on. It's a dystopia. Okay, this dream is a dystopian dream. And we cannot make it anything other than that. It's a fear-based dream. It's an attack-based dream. It's a dream of destructivity, of vulnerability to threat. Because it's a dream of getting rid of reality. So how do we get rid of reality unless we feel a reality is vulnerable to be gotten, to be destroyed? We can just decree it. We can decree it, but it's still there. And it's a fear-based dream. And we're deceiving ourselves, thinking otherwise. It says, what if what I am could be destroyed? Isn't that fearful? That's how it's symbolized. We can't be destroyed, so we have to symbolize it. It's symbolized by what we have, this fear or a feeling of threat or annihilation. You might say it's an annihilation-based dream. So if we looked at human history, if we had foresight thousands and thousands of years ago and could see the future on a video, we would say this is a dystopian nightmare. And yet here we are, so many in this world, confident that the future is going to be just an incredibly wonderful thing. I mean, you're going to have Dick Tracy, smart phones on your watch. You just have all these apps, and you can just know everything there is to know. But as we know with gadgets, we quickly say, ah, wow, that doesn't really solve the issues here. This isn't enough. We need the next, which is why they keep coming out with newer and newer versions, upgrade, that kind of thing. So we're all thinking, oh, the future's going to be great. But a lot of people should be at this time recognizing that technology was a red herring. It's just another one of those things, high tech, to distract us from the spiritual path. Just another one of those things. There's always stuff that it's all designed to distract us away from realizing we're the dreamers of this dream. We're not victims of the world that we see. We're not victims of the dream. We can choose, instead of this dream, we can choose God's non-judgment upon this dream. But that maintains the format of the dream. It's just there's perfect non-judgment upon it all, so none of it affects us. We realize, this is just a dream, but it's unjudged. It's non-judged. There's no judgment upon it at all. And then that actually is felt as this very, very, very profound calm. As Ramana Maharshi said, that this profound calm is higher than any euphoria. Okay, it's higher than that. It's the true bliss, and that is what the goal, our true goal is, because that's what it has to be. Because we have to set dreaming down. We have to set this idea of wanting to be prime creator down, because we don't like it. It doesn't go anywhere for us. It's like a non-experiencing. It's like an experiencing of nothing. We just symbolize this nothing in many ways, but it doesn't go anywhere. And so we need to set it down. We want to set it down, and we're afraid of the continuity issue, which God's non-judgment, perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all what-ifs, solves that problem for us, resolves it for us, and as the experience of this great, perfect calm. Jesus said, peace beyond understanding. Ramana, the deep calm, deep calmness, the great calmness, which is God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all what-ifs. This whole dreaming is, what if this were possible? What if? What if it were possible we could have a world like this that was completely impermanent, and everything that arose here disintegrated? What if we could? What if there were a world of disintegration? What if there's a universe of disintegration? Total impermanence. And what if our identity too was our home? We were dwelling in this world. What if we could have this world, and what if we could dwell in this world, and what if we were dependent on this world for our lives? What if our lives are dependent on this world, and that our lives too would disintegrate, be impermanent? What if all what ifs, which is dreaming is essentially saying, what if, you know, this could take place? What if I was in a car going up this steep valley on roads that were 100% made of blocks of stone and bridges and bulwarks and retaining walls? And what if I ended up on some resort up on a mountaintop and I was looking out over the mountaintop? What if? All the while you're asleep in the bed, going off to what if land. But we don't realize that this whole scenario here is what if land. Hypothetical land, a hypothetical home. What if we had a hypothetical home, is what we're saying. What if we had a hypothetical home? Well, we don't have a hypothetical home. Well, hypothetical home is not our home. Because God creates only what is real, what is eternal, what is endless, invulnerable. And there is nothing else other than that. Everything that is created. What is hypothesized is not real. It's nothing. It is not sustained. It is sustained only by our desire to accomplish the impossible. And we will not keep that desire forever. So it's impermanent, and means it will be as if it never was. Never was. What is impermanent never was in the first place. Okay. What is true is always true. What is not true was never true. So as we remind ourselves of this stuff, 10 minutes later we're back to watching television or something, and we completely forget about it, which is a weird situation. Because everyone you come across in this world is in a state of complete forgetfulness of this stuff. Almost everyone. But in general, I mean, in my life, I'd say as far as actual people I come across, everybody is in a state of complete forgetfulness, meaning the personal contact that people actually see. Now, I read books by those who have some remembrance. You watch videos of those who have remembrance. You can email or text. But as far as actually moving around and meeting, talking to people, etc., I never met anybody who's not in a state of complete forgetfulness. It's crazy. And so we try to beautify this planet, and we knock ourselves out doing that. And for instance, in that dream, I saw the stonework. I said, "My God, it must have taken an army of men working themselves to death." First of all, you have to locate the stone quarry, and then you have to quarry it all. Every single block needs to be hewn. Then it all has to be transported. Then you have to do all the civil engineering and figure out how to do it. And then you have to lay each one of those stones block by block. And then you have to cement them all. I mean, my God, the amount of work, manual labor that has gone into this planet. Just think about how dystopian that is. And how men have just been used as beasts of burden to try and beautify this planet. I mean, when people are going along these roads, does anybody realize the work that went into making those roads? Maintaining the roads? No. People are in their new cars zipping along and they're thinking, hey, this world's a wonderful place. Look at this. They think it's all set, everything was set there by God. No, it's brute labor. Tough, hot. Go home and you just want to slump in your chair and guzzle beer and pass out. You're so tired. Your joints are aching. Your back is killing you. You know, and then you work another day. The next day is another hot day, sweating in the sun. Aching. All your muscles are aching, and nobody has any sympathy for you whatsoever. Get up tomorrow and go out there and lay some more stones. That's the facts. That's the facts of it. So what happens is you start looking at this world, you begin to see the facts of it. It's a dystopia. There's nothing worse than being a naive rich person on this planet, an entitled person, and not having any regard for how everything got here in the first place. I'm looking here. See, I know I'm looking at all these stonework. I did it myself. I laid all these stones, and I know how brutal it was for me, how both my arms went numb for a long time, and every day I was just like from pounding a sledgehammer and a rubber mallet to get all the stones in place and to level. Each stone had to be leveled. Every single stone has to be leveled and carried in. I just exhausted. So I've done a ton of manual labor to find out, hey, what is it like to actually make all this stuff? Is it easy? No, it's not. It's brutal. People driving their cars, they never consider what went into making this car. You know, somebody pulled all that ore out of the ground. Now, of course, we have power equipment now, but in the past, we didn't have power equipment, and it was just brutal slave labor. We used donkeys and mules and oxen and stuff like that, but still, the coal miners still go down into the coal mines, you know, and working on oil rigs is very, very difficult, and working in any mine is very difficult. Getting all the ore, you have to transport all the ore, build all the factories, machinery, people that run it, smelt all the ore, stamp out all the ore, go to tool and die places that they have to cast molds for all the parts. You go on and on and on and on and on for the incredible amount of labor that goes into making a car, a vehicle. Mental labor to organize all this, account for all of it, get the smooth production of all of it. I mean, it is just an enormous, ginormous amount of labor. And that use of natural resources and oil, like the tires, you know, are made of oil, basically, you know, all plastics, and those synthetic materials are largely made out of oil. All to go into this vehicle. We go in there and turn the key, and hey, it works. Miracle. Get drive. Hey, I can just drive all the roads. Where they come from, I don't know, but this is fun. No, the roads come from laying down asphalt and first grading everything, first clearing everything. I know someone that used to, their job was blowing up stumps, tree stumps with dynamite. That's what they did. Had to clear roads, and have roads. You have to get rid of all the trees, all the rocks, all the stones. Brutal stuff. Totally brutal. And then maintaining them all, and then paying for all that, you know. So, and here we are. Touch a button, boom! Car starts, boom! Driving. Say, hey, we live. What a great place we live in. Well, if you want an education, a real education, do the manual labor, as I have done my whole life, of cleaning up all the junk here in this world that falls. You know, that's a real education, because most people, if you're to be middle class, means you can pay a gardener. All right, if you can't pay a gardener, you're not real middle class. All right, middle class means you can pay the dry cleaner, the gardener, the plumber, all this stuff. If you're poor, you got to do everything yourself. Okay, so I've never had a gardener. Never had a gardener. Always insist, you know, I didn't have the money. Never had the money for gardeners, so had done all the gardening work myself, and cleanup, just nonstop cleanup, and just unbelievable amount of trash and cleanup, and the work that I've had has always been the stuff that other people don't want to do. Who they go to college to try to avoid doing that, you see. And so they can have a gardener, they can take vacations, they don't have to do all this total cleanup. Some people twice a week have a gardener, sometimes every day. I know places, the gardeners are every day, making it look like it's a paradise. But what a joke. It's a paradise, one at the cost of slave labor, as it were. It's not quite slave, but you could call it that. I mean, people, either that or they starve to death. So instead of starving to death, they decide they're going to spend every day of their lives doing all the yard work and cleaning up everyone's yard, so it makes everyone's yard looks nice. This yard here, I've done every bit of cleanup here there is, except recently I've had a friend who's helped me out on several occasions, because I'm so tired and feeble now, I can't do it anymore. Not entirely. But I still insist I try to do it all. It's only when my body's just collapsed that I say, hey, you know, maybe it could help a little bit. So it's beautiful, but I know all the hideous work that's gone into it. You know, hideous amount of work. What a nightmare. And maintaining it, it's a nightmare. When I look at the beautiful yard, I don't say, oh, how beautiful is it? I partially, but then I, in the back of my mind, I say, oh my God, what a nightmare maintaining this stuff. What a nightmare. Everything's growing and encroaching, the ivy is encroaching everywhere, you know, what a nightmare. The roads, when I see the roads, I'm not saying, hey, isn't this great, the roads? I said, no, what a nightmare to maintain these roads, because I used to maintain roads, you know. I was on an asphalt patching crew, had my feet burn up from standing on the truckloads full of asphalt and all the oil, you know, and then stenciling all the people. Wait, where are all the stop, all the stenciling on roads come from? Hey, it just magically appears. No, it doesn't. It comes from people. That's all they do is they stencil stop signs and crosswalks and stuff like that. You know, all the civil work, civil engineering work of making the infrastructure. I'm aware of that. How infrastructure, how much work it is, what a pain it is to do that. What a pain. And then all the construction that goes, all the new stuff that goes on, you know what, it creates an enormous amount of trash, enormous amount of waste, and I have to deal with all of that, you see. So you get the real picture of this world. So it's interesting that when you're on the spiritual path, that doesn't mean that you are going to Have a wonderful life. The purpose of the spiritual path is to get a real education so that you accept bliss and you don't get fooled again. So what happened with me was I was unable to go along the path of privilege.